Welcome to ILTV's Israel Daily. I'm Aaron Porras, and coming up in today's newscast, it's over before it started. Israeli classrooms close amidst a scorching May heatwave, and an immunologist explains why most COVID-19 cases in the country come from the United States. As Israel and Iran tit for tat in alleged cyber attacks, we've got what you need to know about your own online safety. A top cybersecurity expert joins us in the studio. Plus, chew with your mouth closed and also with your mask closed? Hear what diners are saying about this snazzy new coronavirus gadget. Temperatures are climbing in Israel, and sadly, so is the coronavirus death toll. Due to the heat, more and more classes are being canceled just days after reopening amidst concerns for the children's well-being, as the health ministry loosens hygiene restrictions for schools that remain open. Tracy Alexander has more.
As the alarm is raised around a second wave of coronavirus, a national heat wave is causing a new set of concerns. Just days after resuming classes, some schools just as swiftly shutting their doors and sending kids back home rather than forcing students to wear masks all day in the blistering heat. Others will stay open, but after a pushback from parents, the health ministry lifting its restrictions that students in fourth grade and above must wear masks.
I think going back to school is phenomenal. I'm very pleased about it. I'm able to get back to some normality, bringing in money and working. But also for the children, I think it's important for them to see that things are going back to normal. This is a very frightening time for them. And not seeing people's faces has been quite intimidating for them, making them very nervous.
It's a move that's also being celebrated by the National Parents Union.
כי בחודשים אלה של השנה, שמזג האוויר חם כל ימות החודש, חשוב שנשתחרר מהמסכות האלה על מנת שילדינו יתמקדו.
The loosened measure comes despite close to 90 Rehovot students being sent back into quarantine within the first week of classes after two staff members were found to have the virus. Nationally, the death toll has now climbed by four, bringing the national figure to 276. The numbers now stand at over 16,600 identified as infected, and of those, more than 13,000 have recovered.
Meanwhile, an investigation is underway after a Jewish New York family arrived in Israel on a private jet, along with the body of a family member who died of COVID-19. The seven family members immediately attending her funeral Monday, along with 100 people, violating the 14-day self-quarantine law. New York is one of the world's worst hotspots for the virus, with the city's Jewish community particularly hard hit by the outbreak. Many virus victims have been flown to Israel for burial. Now, this incident comes just as a new study is published by Tel Aviv University, claiming that more than 70% of Israel's coronavirus patients were infected by a strain that originated in the United States. To tell us more, we're joined by Dr. Adi Stern from the School of Molecular Cell Biology and Biotechnology at Tel Aviv University's George S. Weiss Faculty of Life Sciences. Thank you so much for being with us today. Now, how did you determine where the virus came from? How did you determine that the United States was the culprit?
So we sequenced over 200 genomes of the virus, again, from more than 200 infected patients in Israel that represent a random sample of all infected cases. And we compared the genome sequence of the Israeli patients to over 4,700 genome sequences across the world. And we found a very high degree of similarity between sequences in Israel and sequences in the United States. And in fact, what we could determine is that 70% of the transmission chains in Israel were derived from travelers who had returned from the United States and entered Israel.
All right, well, now flights into Israel from the United States were stopped within days and weeks after the borders were closed to Europe and other countries. How did this influence the figures that your study is presenting?
Yeah, so that was one of the key points that we actually realized when we looked at the data and saw these 70% of transmission strains that are, again, based on our sequencing data. We compared this to the incoming reports of infected travelers, and we saw that only 27% of infected travelers had returned from the United States. And we think that this discrepancy in these two numbers, 27% versus 70%, tells us that people that returned from the U.S. Contributed more to spread as compared to European travelers, and this has to do with a gap in policy. So the borders with the U.S. and were closed a few days after the borders were closed from Europe, and so these few days allowed people that returned from the U.S. and who were presumably sick to travel in Israel, meet friends, relatives, and to spread the virus. And so in Europe, it seemed that the quarantine measures worked. We see very few transmission chains that originated in Europe, but in the U.S. we see this large number of transmission chains in Israel.
All right, now we know that a second wave has historically been a sure thing when easing restrictions too soon during a pandemic. How do we take your research and research like it and apply it sensibly to protect the people from, you know, with the least amount of damage to the economy, country, et cetera?
Yeah, so I think that first of all, what we learned from our study is that closing the borders effectively and on time works, and that's what we see from the European cases, right, and from Southeast Asia. So we see very few to no transmission chains from Southeast Asia and a few from Europe, which shows us that closing the borders on time is a really, really critical measure. And looking forward, I think that's probably maybe the most important take-home message from our study. The second thing that we actually see is that we see that the lockdown measures were very effective in Israel. And I think that by understanding even better how these transmission chains occur, we can actually try and maybe enforce restriction measures that are more localized. And so what we're now starting to study is where the largest outbreaks occur and how we could perhaps enforce these restriction measures in a very in a localized manner and not across the entire country.
So given what you know about Israel's restrictions and its actions up until now, how likely do you think a second wave is in Israel?
So, I was one of the pessimistic ones that actually thought that we might be in a second wave already now. I think Israel is a very closely knit community where with a lot of social interactions, which create a lot of potential for viral spread. I'm happy that this hasn't come through, but I think it really is extremely important to continue adhering to the regulations that are put forth by the Ministry of Health and to really make a huge effort to prevent a second wave.
All right. Dr. Sharon, thank you so much for your time. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on, ministers in the new government taking their seats in several ceremonies Monday. But in the defense ministry, while pleasant, not all is champagne and roses during the handoff of the portfolio. Time for a cheers, but not the usual spectacle at this quiet changing of the guard. Interim Defense Minister Naftali Bennett handing off the defense portfolio to the new co-prime minister and defense minister Benny Gantz as appointments are shuffled after the formation of the 35th Israeli government. Gantz saying it's emotional to return to the ministry's grounds.
אני עושה זאת ביראת כבוד, מתוך תחושת שליחות עמוקה, גם קצת, באמת קצת.
Both ministers addressing the internal threat of coronavirus, but after just 6 months in the position, outgoing Bennett not missing the opportunity to bring the current status of the well-known Iranian threat into focus.
Benny, אני מעביר לך את השרביט כאשר מדינת ישראל נמצאת במצב ביטחוני טוב ויציב, שקט במיוחד, ואיראן החלה תהליך נסיגה מסוריה. אבל אם נרפה ולו לרגע מתנופת הלחץ וההתקפה שלנו עליהם, הכל עלול להתהפך באחת.
Gantz, himself from a military background, as former IDF chief of staff, projecting confidence and humility before the work ahead, already promising to take on the challenges left to him.
מסביב יהום הסער, ואנחנו, מכל גופי הביטחון שלנו, נמשיך לשמור על ביטחון אזרחי ישראל באוויר, בים, ביבשה, בסייבר ובכל מקום שבו יהיה צורך.
Israel has admitted to hundreds of operations against Iranian threats in the region, particularly against their proxies in Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon.
In related news, Iranian authorities scrambling Tuesday, struggling to get systems back on track following reports of a massive cyber attack against its Shahid Rajai seaport, Israel allegedly the source of the hack. According to reports, Jerusalem launched the devastating cyber assault in retaliation for an alleged Iranian attack targeting Israel's water and sewage infrastructure in April. Israeli cyber authorities emphasized that no harm was caused then, however. In Iran, on the other hand, the Shahid Rajai port is one of the most important terminals to the Iranian regime, sitting in the Strait of Hormuz. And this hack targets computers, regulating the flow of vessels, trucks, and goods, crashing them all at once, devastating imports and exports for days, possibly even weeks or longer. And now with details as to why this hack against Iran is so important, joining me is former Secretary of the Prime Minister's National Cyber Initiative and founder and CEO of Confias Computer Security Services, Ram Levy. Thank you so much for coming in. Now, what is the significance of this attack?
Well, this attack comes as a retaliation for the attack that Iran made against Israel against the water and sewage supply on April 24th. So basically, according to the foreign press, if Israel is indeed behind this attack, it's sending a signal back to Tehran saying that this will be that there is a border, there is a fine line that Iran has crossed, and this border should not be crossed again.
All right, now why this port? Because there are plenty of ports. Yeah. In Iran. Why this one?
Dozens of ports. This port is responsible for more than 80% of the import exports of Iran, meaning if you attack this port without the terminal operation systems of the port, vessels cannot charge and discharge containers. Meaning if the systems do not work, you cannot import and export in and outside of Iran.
And I mean, again, I just want to talk about the fallout that will occur from this attack. What do you suspect will occur?
Well, this is not the first time that Israel is attacking Iran and Iran is attacking Israel. Usually what we see is that one side is attacking, the other side is attacking back, and then the deterrence has been kept for a number of months, maybe years. This time we expect that Israel, because of these attacks, will increase the deterrence against Iran, because this is sending a sign to Tehran that we have capabilities, we have the intentions to do it, and we will operate if this will happen again. And I'm assuming that, you know, based on the situation in Iran right now and based on the Israeli capabilities to conduct offensive operations, Iran will refrain from doing that again. Although there's something that we don't know, we are not sure who in Iran was behind the attack on April 24th on the water and sewage supply in Israel. So maybe it's an attack to the Iranian regime. Keep your hackers under control. Don't let them fool around with that.
So there's a chance that this was some random person, you know, black hat hacker, sitting
Absolutely.
In Iran with no connection to the regime?
Absolutely. There are two different problems that we need to understand. One is the security problems. It's very hard to secure systems. What hackers normally do, they scan the entire internet, and then they find a system that's open, and they penetrate into the system. This might be the case that Iranian hackers, that we know that are for Iran, have scanned the Israeli internet, and they found this system that was open, and they just took advantage of it. We don't know that. And then the other problem is that once someone is attacking you, then there are two options that are under their disposal. One is plausible deniability, and two, the ability for the other side to accuse them for doing that. So if you combine those two things together, we don't know who in Iran did it, and therefore Iran can deny that this is not them.
How many attacks like this occur, or likely occur, between Israel and Iran, you know, every year that we don't hear about?
All the time.
Constantly?
All the
every
time.
Day?
I'm assuming every day. If not for offensive operations, for intelligence purposes, all the time.
To what extent do countries rely on electronic infrastructure? Because as you said, I mean, they're scanning the internet and suddenly they say, hey, let's penetrate the water and sewage department. Or, you know, from Israel's side, allegedly, we, you know, crash an entire port.
Well, I would say to the full extent possible. We're 100% dependent on computers. Everything has been controlled by computers, from electricity to our ability to communicate between each other. We are 100% dependent on computers. Therefore, we need to be 100% sure that those computers actually do what we expect them to do, and no one can actually penetrate them from far away and do what they're not expected to do. Okay. So, and this dependency led Israel, by the way, about a decade ago to take leadership and to secure its own cyberspace. And this is a big advantage for Israel because now it's actually quite hard to attack critical infrastructures in Israel, like, you know, the electrical facilities, banks, and sure. so on and so forth.
All right, so it's good that Israel, obviously, their cybersecurity is top in the world, but what about the individuals? What about Israel's civilians or civilians elsewhere? I mean, how should they go about protecting themselves?
Well, I always say it's like cleaning your house. You have to clean your house every week and make sure that it's organized. What does it mean in computer terms? You need to make sure that what you download to your iPhone or your computer is actually what you want. Don't give access to apps. Let's say don't give the flashlight access to your contacts and your location. It's not something that you need. And use basic hygiene. Basic hygiene meaning two-factor authentications for your password, meaning a password and another password that you get from Facebook or Google. Make sure that you have an antivirus and update your computers regularly. We see that most attacks happen because people just did not update their computers regularly and they did not want to restart it because they're lazy. If you're lazy, don't complain.
All right, so you heard it. Update your computer, update your passwords. Ram, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much.
Continuing on Iran, briefly, Iran's parliament is now criminalizing any cooperation with Israel, including using any Israeli computer hardware or software. The Islamic Republic branding any such cooperation as an act against God. The law adopted unanimously ahead of Friday's Al-Quds Day, which is usually marked by regime-orchestrated demonstrations across the country in support of Palestinians and against Israel and the United States. Now let's change gears a bit. As I sit here in this air-conditioned studio, outside is a very different story. Israelis are sweltering through an unprecedented May heat wave with temperatures soaring to a whopping 45 degrees Celsius in parts of the country. That's 113 degrees Fahrenheit. Meteorologists say that if it lasts for the predicted 6 days, this could be the longest May heat wave on record. The intense heat is taking its toll as well. One man died, found unconscious in his car, with medics saying that he had burns on his body from the oven-like temperatures. Firefighters are also battling blazes that have sparked around the country. So what's prompted this extreme heat? To answer the question, Gyora Gerstein from the Israeli Meteorological Service joins us now. Thank you so much for being with us. Now, this is predicted to be the longest heat wave on record, but things change day by day. How are we tracking?
So actually, the weather is not changing from day to day. We have the same temperatures already for a few days, and sadly we are going to have them also till Friday. What is happening is actually quite a usual phenomena for this season, but as you mentioned, the only difference is that this is a very long, really long period. And it might be indeed the longest heat spell we had ever since the beginning of measurements.
So again, I mean, when is this expected to end, or at least to go down to more normal temperatures? As you said, maybe so, Friday or more?
Yes. So the gates of hell are going to be closed on Friday, and probably on Saturday we'll have already much milder weather, and people would be able already to breathe without a mask or with a mask. But till then, we'll have the same 40 degrees Celsius integrated every day, almost anywhere in the country.
All right, so what are the reasons for this situation, though, as you said, this gates of hell being open?
So this is, as I said, it is quite a usual situation for the spring, especially in Israel. This is simply a stationary synoptic system that is not moving. And we see also very high temperatures in Jordan and in Lebanon and Cyprus and even in southern Greece. But there's nothing very special about it, only its length.
All right, so now, if this is happening now, and again, this is May, this is one of the hottest Mays on record, what does this mean for the rest of the summer, like July and August, which are already famously very hot in Israel?
So there's a one slight difference between spring and summer. In the Israeli summer, we do not have mostly such very high temperatures, but in order to compensate it, we have quite high humidity. During those days, now in the spring, we have very, very low humidity percentage, something like between 10 to 20% maximum everywhere. And this is also the reason why we have so many forest fires and fires in general everywhere. What does it say about the summer? It is a very good question. Unfortunately, we are able to predict only the weather for the next few days, but not for the few months ahead. Hopefully, we will not have something similar.
I know we're seeing some of the dangerous and fatal impacts of the heat like this with multiple deaths. What can we be doing to protect ourselves in this heat?
So the best way, I think, would be, I know it is quite difficult to say it after the long lockdown we had, is to stay at home, stay in close places, drink water, put cream, etc. Try to avoid any possibility of digesting a fire or something like that. And simply protect ourselves from the heat as much as possible. Do less sport, move less, everything we were doing during the lockdown, once again.
All right, Gil Gerstein, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Now, I know I've heard this dozens of times. I wish I could protect myself from coronavirus, but still eat and drink. If only it weren't for these hot and annoying face masks. Well, your wishes have been granted. Tracy Alexander has the story.
This might look disgusting, but in these coronavirus times, beggars can't be choosers. An Israeli inventions and patenting company is touting this curious gadget as the best way of keeping our masks on while also being able to eat. And if it isn't already obvious, well, Vice President of Avtipa's Patents and Inventions, Asaf Gitellis, explains.
The mask will be open when you want to eat, and then it will be easy to go to restaurants and to be in the public place, eat and drink. It will be a huge effect on the economy, and then the people will eat and have the protection against the coronavirus.
Israeli restaurants and cafes are set to open in a matter of days. And since strict hygiene measures will have to be enforced, already diners are wondering whether this could be a better solution rather than the classic mask on chin technique.
I think this mask that enables me to eat while I'm still wearing it, it's a must have. Yeah, when I saw the guy just pumping something and it opens the mask and then he eats, I would buy one, I guess.
Although, as Israel sizzles its way into summer, not everyone is convinced.
I don't think this mask could hold with this kind of ice cream. It's dripping all over. I wouldn't want to wear it afterwards.
Maybe if it had an apron, I would use it just to help with the dripping. But I don't think it's very practical without.
Now, the coronavirus has not only banished us to our bedrooms, but the punches just keep on coming. Take a look.
Well, this might not be music to your ears. Much to the disappointment of hundreds of thousands of Israeli fans, the Red Hot Chili Peppers will not be arriving for their scheduled show June 10th. In light of the coronavirus, their whole 2020 tour, including their Tel Aviv show in Parc HaIrkon, delayed until June 23rd, 2021. This cancellation following several other artists like Nick Cave, Morrissey, and Celine Dion too. But as for the Chili Peppers, if you're a ticket holder, don't fret. The band is honoring all tickets purchased. And if you don't have tickets, then good news for you too. Tickets on the grass are still available.
And with that, let's look at the weather forecast. If you're looking at Tel Aviv, you are not facing the worst of the heat wave, with tonight's low sitting at 77 degrees Fahrenheit or 25 degrees Celsius. And as for tomorrow, the mercury is set to hit a high of 101 degrees Fahrenheit or 38 degrees Celsius. So keep topping up those water bottles if you're going to be outside, and just generally stay safe. And now before we go, let's take a look at what's going viral in Israel.
שול, בואי. אין לי כוח לזה יותר, בואי. 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 בואי.
This dog, I think, is my spirit animal. It perfectly represents everyone who is walking around in the heat outside in Israel today. Oof. I feel for him. All right, that is it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.53 shekels to the American dollar. For more news from ILTV, please like ILTV on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube and Roku TV pages. I'm Aaron Porras. Thank you so much for watching.